Hello and welcome back to this Global Health YouTube channel. My name's Greg Martin. This is the second in a series of videos that we're doing on epidemiology and study design and research methods. And in this video, we're going to take a quick look at the difference between case control studies and cohort studies. And we're going to have a look at the relative strengths of each study design. Let's start with case control studies. Now, to do a case control study, where you start is with a group of cases, so people that have a particular condition, they've got a disease, and it's a great study if it's a rare condition or rare disease, right? So you find people that have a disease, let's say for example, we found a group of people who at the age of 21 suddenly find their hair goes green. So we collect those people in a group, we create an analogous group, right? People that don't have that condition but are in every other way similar to the first group, right? Then we look back in time, we look retrospectively at their respective histories and try and identify exposures that may have, and we can look at multiple exposures, that may have led to the condition in this case of green hair. And then we compare these two groups, the people with green hair and the people without green hair, and we try to determine if there is a difference in the extent to which they were exposed to the group of exposures that we're interested in. Okay, so to summarize your case control study, you've got a group of cases and controls. You're looking back in time, so it's retrospective. You can use rare outcomes, right? So you're looking at an outcome and then looking backwards. That's important because when we talk about cohort studies, it's the opposite way around. So you're looking at rare outcomes, you're looking backwards in time, so it's retrospective. You're talking about looking at multiple exposures. Now, importantly, you can do it fast, right? Because you can do the study right now. You can get data today on what happened in yesteryear. And it's cheap, right? Doesn't cost much money to do. Interestingly or importantly, the evidence that you get from a case control study is not considered to be strong evidence. Okay, now let's talk about cohort studies, right? And I want you to understand the difference between these two studies. Now, remember when we talked about a case control study, we started with outcomes of interest, sometimes a rare outcome, and we look back in time at multiple exposures. A cohort study is exactly the opposite. We start off with an exposure of interest, right? So it might be a rare exposure. There's just a few people in the world that have been exposed to something that's unusual. People that have been to the North Pole, right? So we find that group of people. We find an analogous group. We find a second group of people who are in every other way similar to the first group, except they haven't had the exposure of interest. Like these are people that haven't been to the North Pole. But in terms of their demography and their age structures and their socioeconomic strata, et cetera, you try and make sure that they're pretty much the same because you're going to compare these two groups. Now, you look forwards in time and you follow this group up, right? You follow the cohort up over time to see what outcomes emerge over time as a result of that exposure, right? So just to summarize, we're talking about a prospective study. You're looking at rare exposures, you can examine them for multiple outcomes. It takes a long time to do because you've got to follow this group up over time. It's expensive, right? So to run a study like that costs a lot of money. But what you do get out of it is good, strong evidence. So it's stronger. It's considered to be stronger evidence than a case control study. Okay, I hope that was useful. I hope you found that helpful. In the next video, we're going to look at randomized control trials and the idea of confounding. If you're thinking of subscribing to this channel, let me give you one or two reasons why I think that's a great idea. Firstly, if you subscribe to the channel, you get an email alert whenever there's a new video posted, and so you'll be up to date on the things that we say and do here on the channel. But secondly, I send out video content that goes exclusively to people who subscribe to this channel. I think of the people who subscribe to the channel as a kind of a subset of the broader audience, and they're more likely to be people that are interested in job opportunities in the global health space and, you know, where it is that they might find opportunities to do consulting work in global health. And so I'm putting together, they're a little less formal, they're a little less flashy, but videos that are just kind of talk people through what's out there and what's happening in the global health workspace. So subscribe to the channel. Thanks for watching. I'll be back.